Now, Mick Hobday is on the line. Good morning, Mick.
Hello, how you doing?
Good. You visited 60 countries trying to track down the perfect bowl of cornflakes.
Yeah. Right.
We like people like you on this show.
I'm glad by your reaction. That makes me happy, honestly.
Yes, yeah. So, last count, how many bowls of cornflakes have you had, Mick?
In my life or
well,
in the decade?
Well, I don't know.
Or?
Break it down for us. What are you, you're the expert.
It's kind of difficult, really. It's like me asking you, you know, how many plates of chicken he had in the last 10 years.
Okay, so
I can't do exact numbers, to be honest. But, I mean, in my life, probably more than 10,000.
Yes.
In the last decade, God knows, you know, thousands.
You've always been a fan of the cornflakes.
Yeah. Since I was a kid, it's always been, well, it's not just cornflakes, if I'm honest, but they were probably the favourite. I'm a big cereal fan.
Oh,
yeah, that way.
Right, okay.
Yeah, but it's just turned into a cornflake thing as a little bit of a joke, really.
So then you like to travel as well, they say.
Yeah, well, that's the main reason I do it, of course.
So when did this sort of, you know, I'm trying to get to the genesis of this thing. So you were travelling and you had a bowl of cornflakes, as you do, and then maybe the second or third time you got, they taste completely different to the other ones. Is that the way it happened?
No. I mean, really, actually what happened, the travelling started first.
Okay.
So basically I went to uni and then graduated and, you know, I was faced with getting a job and thought, no thank you. And so I decided to go off travelling. And then after a couple of years of you know, backpacking around South America, I figured I wanted to go everywhere. And then I figured, you know, to make it sort of different and unique, I just add a sort of funny side to it, and that's where the cornflakes came in, really.
Okay. Now, you know, I know this for a fact, that Kellogg's don't make cornflakes for anybody other than themselves.
Yeah.
For example, Weetabix will make own brand Weetabix for, you know, chains of supermarkets.
Yeah.
So you've had, obviously, the you know, Kellogg's cornflakes, and then what you have around the world are own brand stuff, is it?
Well, yeah, if I'm honest with you, it's basically, I like to try and support the local thing. I mean, if they were grown in that town, then I would prefer that. But I'd kind of try and support the local thing. So I've always steered away from Kellogg's because they're a big multinational American company.
But they're the original. Did they come up with the idea?
I don't know. I mean, the funny thing is that the papers have turned this into a massive cornflake thing, and I'm no cornflake expert, trust me. I just buy a box in each country I go to,
yeah,
and I have some cornflakes.
But you are, really. You know, there are not many people who've had a bowl of cornflakes in 60 countries. That makes you an expert, whether you like it or not, Mick.
Well,
I'm sorry, that's why we're talking to you.
Well, that's a fair point, I guess. Fair enough. And then you can pick my brains then for my cornflake knowledge.
Well, you see, because a bowl of cornflakes, there's a lot to it. There's the ambience of where you are, there's the actual flake, and then there's the milk, which I think is probably you know, the most important thing, because milk to me tastes completely different all over the world.
Well, yeah, I mean, that is actually, I mean, people have been asking, all these reporters have been asking about the flakes. I've said to him, you know, you can't describe a cornflake with too many words, really, because it's just, you know, small and orange, isn't it, really? But the milk is the killer thing, that's for sure.
Yeah.
I mean, the worst bowl I ever had was in Mauritania, and that was with camel's milk, and it was just...
It just seems wrong, doesn't it?
Yeah, it wasn't just that it was camel's milk. I'm sure under certain situations it's okay, but it was the fact that it was in the desert and it was warm, and the milk, yeah, it just didn't really go well.
What does camel milk taste like?
I don't know. It's really sort of tepid, and I don't know how to. It's kind of, it doesn't taste like ordinary milk. It's kind of, it had sort of lumps in it. Not lumps, like big lumps. It was just kind of had that kind of rice pudding-y kind of.
Oh, so it's slightly coagulated.
Yeah, exactly.
So, you know, something that sprung to mind. I don't know why, but underarm. Does it taste like underarm? No.
I'm not expert enough yet, I don't think, in my field. I need to do more research.
Excuse me, can I lick your underarm, please? I want to compare it to camel milk. Thank you.
Well, yeah, I mean, if someone wants to put me on TV for doing that, then why not, you know?
Right,
I'm up for anything.
And the milk wasn't... I think, in your head, I know Egypt. Just describe, this is your top bowl of cornflakes was in Egypt.
That's right.
Why does it get the top
slot?
Well,
it was actually more for, I mean, again, there's not that much variety in cornflakes, so it's not like I can say my top five is really that distinct. I was kind of just really trying to think about it.
Yeah.
But Egypt is my favourite just because of the location. Like you say, I don't focus just on taste,
yes.
I focus on what I'm looking at and all that kind of stuff.
The whole package.
Yeah, and to be amongst the, on the Giza Plateau, amongst those massive pyramids that are just amazing, was just, that was what made it. And if I'm quite honest with you, I can't even remember what the cornflakes tasted like. But
how are you going to keep your milk cold there?
Maybe? I couldn't.
And the
papers, again, is hilarious, really. The papers, again, have got it all wrong. I didn't cycle to the pyramids in Egypt, and I didn't have ice cold milk either.
Yes.
I don't know where they get these things from, but I had warm milk, and it was
You'd be interested in this, because I know you've been traveling around, you might have missed this in your travels, but in America now, they're selling cereal milk.
Right.
It's that it's that milk that's left in the bowl when you've eaten all the cornflakes. How about that?
Oh my God. God, what will they come up with next?
Yes.
That's hilarious.
Well, you've no right to be throwing stones now. You're in a glass house.
That's true. Yeah,
right,
I'll put all my stones down.
What are you going to do next? You've written a sort of a blog, travelblog.org. And you've published online The Adventures of a Hard Up Diabetic Traveller with a Cornflake Problem.
Yeah, that's right. My mission in life will stay the same until I've completed it. So obviously I want to go to more countries.
Yeah.
But having just published the book a few weeks ago, I now want to, I'm also wanting to make films, make sort of documentaries for YouTube.
Right.
So I've got a project running on this sponsoryoume.com website that people can donate for me to make this movie, this documentary about all the sort of Stonehenge places in the UK. I'm doing that in 2 weeks' time. I'm going to be driving around the UK for a couple of weeks filming. And then after that, I just need to have a relax, really. So me and my wife are going to go to India for 5 months. Yes,
that's
I'm
mad.
Married. Yep.
What does she think of your relationship with cornflakes?
She kind of just doesn't have a choice to think that it's okay, really.
Yeah.
I mean, it's obviously a bit wacky.
Which came first? Well, obviously your cornflake thing came first, didn't it?
Yes.
So she knew what she was getting into.
Funny enough, no, it didn't, because my wife, we met at school when we were, so I met her when I was 11 years old, so
she actually
came first, yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, she was. It wasn't a high school sweetheart thing. When I was 16, I moved away, and we didn't see each other until we were 31. But then we met up again, and within 3 days we were engaged. So it was quite a sort
what
of.
What a lovely story, mate!
It was,
and it's Valentine's week and everything.
Is it? Oh yeah, I remember that.
Yeah, breakfast in bed, dear. Guess
yeah,
what?
Right. Yeah. Cornflakes in bed. Yeah.
So 11. And you were just, did you even notice each other then? Were you friends?
No, we were friends. We were best friends. And we were best friends for 5 years. And then, like I say, when I was 16, my family moved from
the
South
Coast. Yeah, so there's no kissing or anything. It was just friends.
Yeah. I think we went out on a school disco for about 3 hours or something
right.
But nothing serious.
And then back together at 31, and within 3 days engaged. That's
yeah,
a great story,
exactly
isn't it?
That. And it was funny. It was quite strange, really, to see what we'd written in each other's leavers diaries and things like that. It was quite sort of, I don't know, there was hints in what we said that our future would be together kind of thing. It was quite strange, but...
Oh, because did you kept thinking of her through from 16 to 15 years?
No. It was more things like, I didn't mean to go into too much detail like I ran out of money at the time, and then we got together and we started reading our leavers books, and she'd sellotape 5p into the diary and said, if you ever run out of money, look me up. So she wrote that when she was 16, and I actually did look her up when I ran out of money, because I got back from Egypt and had nothing left. And we didn't do that on purpose, you know. It was just one of those things, and we thought, oh my God, look at that. That's and there was other things written in the diary that made us think, wow.
It was destiny.
Kind of, yeah.
Have you had, people are asking various questions now of you. Ask the guy if he has ever tried fresh pouring cream over crunchy nut cornflakes. Absolutely decadent.
Really?
Yeah.
That's sounds nice, actually.
Yeah.
No, I haven't tried it, but I would love to. Maybe I'll come to Ireland. And
you've had cornflakes in Dublin. That's one of your 60.
I have, but I haven't. I need to come back, because I haven't taken a photo.
All right, okay.
Yeah, when I was in Dublin, it was, I think it was 7 or 8 years ago, and I wasn't really taking the cornflake thing that seriously at the time. Right. It's only been in the last few years. So I ate my bowl of cornflakes. I think I was hungover because I'd had the night on the Guinness, you know, so right. It wasn't the most memorable of bowls.
I don't think it's a good hangover thing. So ironic he should say that my best bowl of cornflakes was in Cairo, sitting on a balcony over the Nile, topped with local milk and honey.
Where did it say that?
This is a texter, Barry Norman
Barry Norman.
So he says, I've spent the intervening years trying to in vain to replicate it, but unsuccessfully. It's driven me to the point of madness. And somebody says, Mr. Kellogg was a psychologist who invented cornflakes to stop boys masturbating. The logic was bland food would help. So I don't know how true that is.
Oh my goodness.
Sounds good.
Wow. That explains a lot to me. I can't tell you on air, but that explains so much.
His thought process ran something like this: how can I justify travelling a lot? Travel journalist, too much work, pilgrimage, too pious, I know, cornflakes, says Matt Ngoa. So that's, he's trying to get inside your head.
Right.
Tell that man I think that camel had mastitis. If the milk was lumpy, don't worry, it's only milk full of infection. That's all you had.
Oh, lovely.
He is a serial traveller, yes. I'm bowled over. Yeah, there are the puns that are coming in. But the milk is different everywhere, so does he carry a big silo of full fat around with him? No, that's all part of the thing, isn't it?
I buy it locally. Of course, I don't travel around with it.
There was a lovely thing. You're too young to remember, though. When you're not, but when milk arrived in bottles at your front door, it wasn't whatever way the process of pasteurizing it. The cream used to settle at the top.
Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah, so we used to sprint to the fridge in our house because that was the real tasty part of it. So if you got the lovely creamy bit over your cornflakes in the morning, it was just mmm.
Yeah, I know. It used to put me off as a kid. I don't know why. You didn't like
the creamy bit?
No, well, I didn't like bits in my yogurt either, kind of thing.
Oh,
you know? Anything that had sort of
You're a fussy eater, yes.
Well, I was. Not now. Not now. I've eaten all sorts of things now. I've eaten insects and ox testicles and all sorts. So I've lost my fussiness.
Right. We will have to talk to you again, Mick Hobday. Thanks for sharing your adventures with cornflakes with us.
No problem.
The Adventures of a Hard-Up Diabetic Traveller with a Cornflake Problem. That's where you'll get Mick Hobday, H-O-B-D-A-Y. Thanks, Mick. Good luck.
Thank you very much.
Bye. Quick commercial break.
The Ray Darcy Show on Today FM.